Mr. Jamie Holder. Well, welcome to Bric Art Medium, to my art show, Artistic Talent. And I'm really happy to see you here. It's an honor, it's a pleasure. And I know you got a lot of things, a lot of stories, messages that you want to share with the community. And I'm happy to hear that message or that story that you want to share with me. So I got a lot of questions to ask you. And we'll see how this thing goes. I'm pretty sure it's going to go very good. By the way, my name is Melvin Isaac. And this is my show, the Artistic Talent Show. And we are at Bric Art Medium, downtown Brooklyn, 647 Fulton Street, right around the corner from Rockwell Place. Okay? So the first question I want to ask you is this. How would you describe yourself?
Well, I'm more like a commercial artist, but I was trained as a commercial artist. And then later on I switched over to being a fine artist. And it's one of those things where, like, it's never set in stone where you're going to wind up when you get into the art world, whether commercial art or fine art. You know, it's sometimes you just have to go with what's there and what's offered to you.
Yeah, and never stay in stone. What inspired you to wake up every morning?
I think, like, wanting to get better at drawing and painting and just expanding my own creativity and my own development as an artist. And those are key fundamental things that I do every morning to try to improve that. Every day I draw, every day I sketch. So it could be just little doodles, or it could just be a workout for a painting, or lay out for a page or something. There's always some creativity in the beginning of the morning to get me going, and that's my core foundation, is to become better and stronger in my art.
Who inspired you?
Oh, I have so many people. So many
that's
people.
That's
I had
a good question there.
Yeah, I have very. I had teachers that inspired me. The very first one was Mrs. Fox in my junior high school, and she passed away. But I never really got a chance to, you know, see her again. But she encouraged me and got me to go to Art and Design High School. And after that, it was Mr. Greenberg, who is also a teacher at Art and Design High School. And because of him and Mr. Ginsberg, I went from wanting to do comic book art to doing illustration for book covers. And I really developed my skill with them and different schools, and also myself. A lot of times it was just my own practice on my own that really, I felt, really improved my skills a lot. And then on top of them, but actually I should say before them, really, was Frank Fazetta. He's a big name, and I knew him, I knew of him and his artwork well before I even went to Art and Design High School, and I would draw from his books. And Bridgman, George Bridgman, he was a big influence. I used to draw from his books constantly just to get the foundation of solid shapes, because you can't be a really good painter if you're not, if you can't draw very well. So without those two foundations, and I think Frazetta showed me, like, what you can do with these shapes, with these you know, images, what, you know, if you can draw, you know, you can, the sky's the limit. Your imagination can take you, can produce anything for you right in front of you on a canvas.
Mm-hmm. Well, what challenges have you struggled with to become an artist? What are your challenges?
Well, I think the biggest challenge, I think, was financial. I got support from my family that, you know, enjoyed me doing artwork, but I think the big thing was like trying to make a living at it. That was like the hardest thing. And I worked as a production artist for 14 years, and then I moved on. I did a couple of book illustrations and book cover illustrations, and now I'm teaching. I have a meetup, and I'm gonna be going into a more hands-on teaching mode in terms of figure drawing and regular drawing. Right now I have a meetup as a just figure live comic art drawing at the B-Dry. But later on, I want to move on to, you know, hands-on showing people who don't really know how to draw, and even directing them to books that inspired me, like the Bridgman books, like Frazetta, like Andrew Loomis, who came later on, but who's always been around, but I never saw any of his books or got any of his books until a few years ago. And I was really inspired by his work. I really loved the work that was in these books. And a person recently said to me, "You have a style kind of like that." And I was very flattered by it, that he could see the influence of this artist on my work. Yeah.
So how long have you been an artist? Long time.
Long time, since the 70s.
Yeah.
And I don't think I ever, I never really quit. There are times I didn't work in the commercial art field, and there are times I just had to get a regular job doing whatever, but I never stopped painting or drawing. And that's been like an ongoing thing, and it probably will be for the rest of my life. I don't think I'll ever stop drawing or painting unless, you know, something happens to me physically, you know, but aside from that, you know. And I love it. I think that's the best thing about being an artist, is there's no retirement, there's no end to it. It's just an ongoing process.
Yeah, yeah. So let me ask you, are you self-taught, or did you learn this by going to art schools?
Well, I was kind of self-taught, because I took the books and I would draw from them during the summertime, on the weekend, whenever I have free time. I would draw from these books constantly, and so I believe I was self-taught, but only to like a certain degree. I had books to, I can compare my work with the work in the books and see where I stood. You know, like if my work wasn't up to par, I would be honest enough to say my work doesn't look as good as that work. And but then later on, when I went to art and design high school, a lot of times we didn't cover these things like figure drawing. We had drawing, you know, just drawing life, drawing and stuff like this, and painting from life, but we didn't have any figure drawing classes. And so I believe I was self-taught, but then I was kind of, I could polish, and I feel like I polished my own work, but having some instruction from a teacher later on, it did help.
Yeah.
It did help. It always helps.
So, who are you and what is your purpose in life?
Well, I've always, you know, thought about, like, if, when I left this world, what would be my, you know, what I would like to have, what would be my biggest accomplishment? And I think to have a large body of artwork, good artwork, that to inspire people that I'll probably never meet or see or get a chance to talk to, but to be able to touch somebody in the future with my work and have them say, or a young person say, this is what I want my life to be about, painting and drawing, and I want to do these things too, you know. I feel that that's a very important and very a great thing to be able to have to, you know, if I can reach that level and if I can touch somebody in that way, you know, that would be like the best thing I could possibly imagine, you know, making my life worthwhile here on Earth, to inspire people in the future.
Yeah. Well, you know, you probably already have touched a lot of people's lives, inspired a lot of people, you know, since you've been doing art, you know. They probably been expressing that to you, you know, a lot, you know. But to leave that behind, that's a great inspiration, encouragement to leave for other people, you know. That my purpose to leave this behind, to inspire you. That's why I'm here, so that's a great thing. So when did you start drawing?
Well, I think I started drawing when I was like maybe 5 or 6. Because my brother was an artist. Right. And I was just following along with my other two brothers who are drawing and stuff. They don't... one, I'm not sure, is still drawing, but the other one, he still dabbles in art and whatnot. But I was influenced and started drawing because of them. And then, you know, comic books were like the key foundation for all that. And so if you want your work to look like what you see in these comic books, you really have to be up to par. And I, when I was younger, I used to be very frustrated because I couldn't draw as well as them, but I kept trying. That's it.
So how many mediums do you work in?
Ooh. I can work in black and white ink. I can work in watercolor. I can work in acrylic. And I can work in oil paint. And I'm pencil and charcoal.
Versatile, huh?
Yeah.
Did you attend any art schools?
Well, art and design high school. I got a 1-year scholarship to attend the Art Student League. And I went to Pratt Institute for a few years. I think that's about it.
That's good. Do you belong to any art organization?
Not at the moment, but I would like to join the Fulton Art. Artists on the fence,
yes,
thing that I believe they're
Fulton Art Fair.
Fulton Art Fair.
Okay. That'd be good. Have you had any commissions?
Just to do book covers, no portraits or anything like that. But I'm not really a portrait artist. I'm more like a commercial artist. I've done animal portraits. Right. And stuff like that, and people have enjoyed those. And I've done book covers, I've done that. Mm-hmm.
So this is a final question here. What do you consider to be the most important in your life of art?
Of art, the most important thing, you mean for me?
Yeah, what do you consider is important to do in art?
I think honesty. I think it's very important, you know, to be honest with yourself when you're doing art. You know, did you do a good job? Can you do a better job? How could you do a better job? When you ask these questions about yourself, you can go deeper, and you know, and I believe it's one of the things that you really want to have a, you want to be honest with yourself when it comes to art. You don't want to fool yourself that you're great and then you're not very good. You want to be honest. You want to tell you, you find out how to do it if you don't know how to do it. And I think that's very important. Honesty, you know, it's, I think that's another trait of art that I like the most, is being able to look at something and see the, what it, see it for what it is. Is it really good or is it not good? You know, and then there's that, there's always that opportunity that you can take to be better.
Yeah.
It depends on the person's drive and, you know, inside of them. You know, if you really want to do something, you can do it. And I, that's the one thing I like about art. It doesn't discriminate. It doesn't put barriers up. It's still all about you and your determination and your will and your drive.
That is true. I just want to comment on what you just said, which is very positive. You have a lot of people, some artists, some, not all. But I guess that's like at the beginning of learning or getting involved with art, that they don't accept positive criticism of their work, and that's like a downfall, the way I see it, my opinion, that in order to be, like you were saying, being honest with yourself about your art, but also accept criticism, you know, through from other artists, because if you feel that your work is really good, but you haven't had nobody else's opinion, other artists, criticize it, it's a downfall, because now, you know, you wonder why is nobody's buying the art, why is this happening, I'm not getting any recognition, because of accepting it, that maybe you need to practice more of this, maybe you need to be honest about it, and some artists is not honest about it, but you brought a very good point there, of being honest about your art, about life, with your art. And that is a, you know, a criticism. So that's just one point.
Well, when you are, when you do go and you get criticism, you also have to make sure you're getting criticism from somebody that really, you know, understands and knows what they're doing or knows what they're talking about. Sometimes, you know, a layman, the average person on the street, can give you some criticism too, some good criticism. But I think, More than that, it probably, you have to get it from an artist or somebody who has experience. They can really direct you and as to what exactly is wrong, what exactly you need to do. And then sometimes it might not be that the art is bad. It might be that you're pitching it to the wrong people. If my artwork, I was supposed to have a show at a 60, I'm supposed to have some art in a window at 60 Hudson over in Tribeca. And the woman that was supposed to approve it said that there was one or two pieces that they thought that the neighborhood might find offensive or scary. And it was just a woman laughing, being surrounded by carousel horses. And she thought it was, she thought that it was too scary for the neighborhood. And I didn't, it, there was this one image of a guy in the background, but there was nothing that was really strong that would make the whole thing look so scary that it couldn't be presented to the public, even to children.
Right.
And it was an eye opener for me, because she gave me this criticism that it might be scary, where I thought it was tame, and I thought, and my wife and I thought it was tame, but to this person, this outsider, this, it would seem somewhat scary and threatening, even though it looked like a happy image. At night, you know, the carousel, the horses going around, and a woman laughing.
You never know, it's an eye-opening.
Yeah, it's an experience, a learning experience. Yeah. You know, whenever you put your work out there, somebody's going to have something to say about it. Sometimes it's going to be good, sometimes it's not necessarily bad, because I was going for more of a, like a theme, a darker theme, but I didn't think that was really coming across that well. But apparently I was a little bit more successful than I was at it, but for this particular show or window display, I guess it was a little too much.
Okay. Well, with that thought, you'll be telling us a little bit about your art, and we're going to have your art on the screen in back of you.
Okay.
And each one of them, you're going to elaborate on that art, and then we can see for ourselves, you know, about your expression in your artworks. Tell me about this art that we are looking at now in back of you.
Well, first, I really wanted something with dramatic lighting. And I felt that this woman's face was really very dramatically lit. And at the same time, I wanted something that was provocative and shocking, like the red in the background, which is the name of this painting is A Splash of Blood. So I really wanted to invoke, you know, or get the viewer excited, but at the same time they could look and see the quality of the artwork of the face and stuff like this. And I wanted to make it a little bit more interesting, and I really wanted the viewer to come up with their own story. So I give you these elements like the bird and the guy in the background and the object in his hand, and I really wanted you to put together like a story in your mind. And it could be any story you want. And a lot of times that's what art is. It's very, you know, objective. Whatever you think it is, that's what it is. Now, if the artist came up and told you what they, you know, were painting, and it wasn't the story you had in your mind, it could change the whole artwork for you.
Yeah.
And you may not like it as much. So that's why I like to leave it open. So that the viewer, or if someone purchased it, this would be their piece of art, and it would be what they wanted it to be.
Okay. And what was the name of this art?
A Splash of Blood.
So tell us about this one right here.
This one, it's one of my favorites because it really is a throwback from my childhood to watching old movies about robots and monsters and stuff, seeing old TV shows, Creature Feature, and it was just a lot of fun for me to do because I like the atmosphere and just incorporating this giant robot in there. Really, it was a lot of fun. I enjoyed painting it, and I think anybody looking at it will get a sense of these old movies, but I brought in the color. I didn't do it in black and white because I felt that color would make it a little bit more vivid and a little bit more alive for the viewer. And once again, they could make up their own story. The woman could be controlling the robot, or, you know, she just finds the robot. Or the robot could be menacing and might be about the killer or do something, who knows. But they have the option to make up the story.
Yes. Yes, they do. Okay, so tell us about this particular one right here.
Well, in this scene, this painting, my wife and I were walking over in Tribeca, and we saw this building that was illuminated a little bit and then very dark at the top, and it just caught my imagination. I had to, you know, put it down on canvas. And as I was putting it down on canvas, there was no Zeppelin in the scene. And my imagination took it. And I could have put like a flying saucer in there, but I wanted something a little bit more down to earth. And I thought this Zeppelin would be, would just make the whole composition of the painting come to life. And, you know, even though it's not really a stretch of the imagination, it's a feel, it's a mood that I really wanted to incorporate in this painting. And I just whenever I look at this painting, I just love the atmosphere. It really brings me, we could have been in a movie. You know, it's just that type of night, that rainy night, with beautiful lighting in the back of these lights here at the bottom, street lights, and just the sky being lit up by a skyscraper in the background. Awesome. And that's one of the things I like, that I try to incorporate in my artwork, is scenes from New York City, because I grew up here. I, you know, lived here all my life, and every once in a while I fantasize about living somewhere else. But New York City, it just has all these nuances that you can only find in small amounts in other cities. But in New York City, you have a ton of them. You have tons of them. And I can't see myself living anywhere else than New York.
Well, Jamie, it came to the end of the program here. And I really appreciate you being here.
Well, thank you for having me.
You're a very talented, extraordinary artist that one can definitely learn from, and you inspire so many that I'm seeing right now, especially through the three art pieces that you shared with us to the world. And I want to thank you very much.
Thank you for having me again.
Thank you. And now that I can still become, you know, your host to interview you again on my show.
Anytime.
Okay. Thank you very much.